the clock management, and then the fifth thing is the noise management. This is a part of the system level design. So here we'll not be concerned about more about designing the gates. We'll not be concerned about that, because my aim is to go one step higher and see what problems can occur at the system level design, where I am mostly looking at a block level design of my system. I'm understanding the block level design of my system. So block level communication is happening from one block to another block, maybe unidirectional way or a bidirectional way, maybe through parallel communication technique or a serial communication technique. So in a parallel, what problems can come up? In a serial, what problems can come up? Under what condition I should use a parallel communication? Under what communication I should use a serial communication? And then should I go for how to distinguish if a data, proper data has arrived? It is not a garbage, or a new set of data has arrived. So to understand that the arrival of the new or the change of the data, because data would be coming one after the another. So somehow the block must recognize that a new set of data has come. So we should have some kind of an enable, some kind of a signal which triggers, which lets the receiver to know that a new data is arriving. It should start latching it in and then process it. So we can go by a clock, a global clock signal, or we may go by a completely asynchronous approach where there is no global clock signal. So what problems we encounter when we go for a global clock as an enable signal? So this is called as a synchronous system design. Within synchronous, there can be two, three approaches. First is the system synchronous, then the source synchronous, and third is a self-synchronous. In one case, very easy transmitter receiver designs, but then you have to design a completely new clock generation and distribution domain. But transmitter receiver designs will be very, very simple. If you go for the system synchronous, then transmitter design becomes complex. Transmitter has to now send a clock signal every time to the receiver. So system design of a receiver becomes more complex. And then the second block will become a transmitter for the third block. So same thing goes for every block. Every block design will be difficult. Then you come to the self-synchronous, where transmitter sends both data and clock together, and then receiver design has to recover clock signal separately and the data signal separately. So that here the receiver becomes very, very complex. So entire clock data recovery circuits, they have to be created within the receiver. As a result, I can think of various approaches. Each approach has its own pros and cons. Then we said, okay, let us start understanding the flow of information and hazards that can come up by taking a very simple first approach, which is my source, which is my systems. What is that? Which approach? I think system synchronous. I think I've just forgotten. Where both receiver and transmitter domains, I'll tell you the name, is there in my slide. Both receiver and transmitter domains are in the same clock domain. That means same clock signal goes to receiver as well as the transmitter. Here, receiver is the first block sending the data, transmitter is a block which is sending the data. A receiver is a block which is receiving. Remember, first and second, one transmitter, one receiver, second, third, the second becomes transmitter, third becomes receiver. Now here it can be IC to IC communication, it can be PCB to PCB, it can be block to block, it can be module to module. See, you can have a level of hierarchy. So we can have a communication at the lowest level of hierarchy, or we can have a communication at the highest level of hierarchy, that is IC to IC communication. Because situations are different, length of the wires will be different accordingly. I sometimes may be choosing a serial communication for a very long wire communication, or I may be going for a parallel communication approach where I would be sending all n bits together but through n wires. Because there would be too many wires, n number of wires would be required for parallel communication, And if all of them, worst case, all of them changing at the same instant of time, a lot of noise is generated, which results into a lot of capacitive coupling because wires will be very closely placed. They are kind of a parallel plate capacitor structures. As a result, a lot of capacitive coupling takes place and data gets corrupted. There's a very high chance the data will get corrupted. So this is something that we did in last 2-3 classes. Okay, and then we start, okay, something that you have already done. So it is just a revision. So if you take a global clock system, open loop means something that, then we discuss eye diagram. So data is kind of a eye diagram, where you have the data rising, then remaining stable, and then falling. Or other way around, data falling, remaining stable, and then going up. So you can have two-way approaches. So if you combine them together, it becomes an eye diagram. Then we said a good eye diagram is the one which is having the maximum eye opening. And we understand that by putting or fitting a square in that. Largest the square you are able to fit. That means largest, better is my eye diagram. Now eye diagram has time on the x-axis and the voltage or magnitude, voltage or current, whatever you are using to represent your signal on the y-axis. So I may have the shifting, I may have the zip, I may have the noise represented coming up on the time x scale. I may have a noise coming up on the voltage scale or the current scale or the magnitude scale. As a result, if you lower is my eye opening, means there's a lot of noise in the magnitude level. And if my this dimension is smaller, then there is a lot of uncertainty or noise on the time scale. Basically, uncertainty is composed of basically two things, skew and jitter. These are the two major reasons for getting uncertainty in timing or timing noise. This is called as a timing noise. Similarly, your voltages may not be rising fully. Sometimes your voltages levels, they go down. I'm talking about voltage level signaling. As I said, it can be a current level signaling also. As a result, the maximum voltage level may not be going. It may be dropping down. So sometimes it goes full, sometimes it goes less. So if you over a period, if you observe the signal and start overlapping every signal one over the another, you get an eye diagram. And maximum, if your eye opening is maximum, means the voltage noise, AC voltage noise will be, or AC noise, or AC magnitude noise will be minimum. Remember that. We always want to have a very clean eye with minimal AC voltage noise and minimal timing noise. Always. If it is not so, that means my system is prone to errors. Very, very much prone to errors. So after discussing the eye diagram, we started looking at the first approach, open loop global clock system. Closed loop, as I said, can give you a better data rates because everything, it is all, ultimately I want a higher data rates. How quickly I can send my signal from one block to the next block. Ultimately, system is characterized by high data rate. So if I want a very, very high data rate, suppose I'm starting with a system synchronous design where my transmitter receiver are in the same clock domain, I'm using an open loop global clock. So I'm going for a synchronous timing. When I say there's a clock, the moment there's a clock, there is a synchronous timing. When it is asynchronous, no clock is there. Still, I want to distinguish whether a new data is coming or not. That is called as a, I would be requiring hand shaking signals. Hand shaking signals are generated by a transmitter to the receiver, receiver to the transmitter. When the data is available, transmitter sends a request to the receiver. When the receiver latches in the data, it gives a signal acknowledgement to the transmitter back. So it says, okay, I have got the output latched in. You can start processing a new data. You can change your output. Your initial previous output is safe to be. So these signals, which are called as a request and acknowledge, they need to be generated by the blocks themselves. So they are local in nature. They are locally generated. Whereas global clock becomes a global signal. Always remember. Clock is a global signal, whereas the handshaking signals are local. So now we all know that if you go by a synchronous timing approach, system synchronous, one transmitter, one receiver. Okay? So how fast my signal can go depends on how small is your clock period. So if it is 1 gigahertz at which clock I am generating, that means after every 1 nanosecond I am transmitting a new bit. Every 1 nanosecond I am transmitting a new bit. So it's very easy for the receiver to understand that 1 nanosecond a new bit is coming. It is certainly not a garbage signal. It is not a corrupt signal. So it is very easy to distinguish whether a new data is arriving or not. It's very easy because after every 1 nanosecond there is a new bit coming. It's very easy. Fine. So whether it is the same signal being continued, 0, 0, logic, 0, logic, logic, doesn't matter. But nanosecond means a new bit. It's as easy as that. So very easy to distinguish or understand the arrival of a new set of new data. As I said, how fast is my data rate can be very well understood by writing an equation for the T clock. How small is can be your T clock? For a data to move from transmitter to receiver, how small can be your T clock? Now, I may have a system which is composed of only, say, a kind of a shift register, where you have only sequential elements, 1, 2, 3, 4, no processing required. So it's kind of a very simple system, mini system, can be a shift register, or it can be a more complex system, where I have different blocks communicating with each other, one block sending data to the next. As a result, processing is happening. So when you create a data movement from one block to the next block, first edge of the clock comes, the data goes to the transmitter. Transmitter processes it, puts the output at its output terminal, data at the output terminal. Then it goes through the wires to the receiver. Receiver will process the signal at the next edge. So from the transmitter first clock edge to the next clock edge, what can be T clock? You all have done that. What can be T clock? Expression. T clock expression. Now here can be two approaches. One is that you are not having any kind of latching in phenomena, latching in conditions. Otherwise, I can have a processing unit combined with a latch or a flip-flop. So I can have the data coming to the transmitter getting latched in through a flip-flop and then it is processed. Produces the output, goes to the receiver, again gets latched in through a flip-flop. So these flip-flops can be operating at the edge of the clock. They can be positively edge triggered, they can be negatively edge triggered. Secondly, you may replace a variant where every flip-flop is replaced by a latch, level sensitive, level triggered. It's not edge triggered, it can be replaced by a latch. It is just a variant of edge trigger. Second thing can be, we are not having any kind of a latching phenomenon, nothing. No way to store the data. It's only one block, second block, third block. Now at a system level design, this doesn't work. It may work for a very, very primitive level design where one gate giving output to the next gate, then the third gate. There you need not require to put a sequential element every time in between. It is not required. Suppose I am creating an adder. I don't require to put after every gate a sequential element. It's not required. So at very, very primitive level, we normally go for a bare pipeline systems where we do not have any sequential elements after or before the processing elements or a gate, arithmetic, logical block or whatever you have, logical block. I don't require. But at the system level, normally, when we go for a block to block, a big block, second block, which may be within IC. Okay, we usually have, it is always better to have a sequential element interspersed in between two CLBs. So that data is stored in a sequential element, it is processed by a CLB, moves forward, again comes to the second block, again it is preceded by a sequential element. So that when the data is safe with the second block, first block can change its by starting to process the new set of data. So normally it is always a sequential element which is nothing but a D flip-flop. It is always a D flip-flop. As simple as that. Very simple D flip-flop at the edge of the clock. It opens up. As it opens up, the data moves in. So every sequential element has its timing properties. And we all know that timing property. Setup time and hold time and T clock to P. every sequential element has these three timing properties: clock to queue delay, setup time, and hold time. Remember that. And then in addition to that, as data is processed by a CLB, there would be a logical delay coming up. So T logic. There would be a logical block delay. So T logic will be there. So ultimately, there would be these four parameters coming in my T clock expression. It would be T setup, T hold, and T clock to queue, and T logic. Here I am assuming that my clock is completely ideal. So see, I am not repeating anything. Whatever I did in the last 2-3 classes, I am just telling you so that you come in continuity with what we have done till date. Fine. As a result, so we have complete. So what my expression max minimal time I should have for a data to move from one block to next block will be nothing but for ideal clock situation, starting from one edge to the next edge. Okay, this is my time period, T clock. So first edge, transmitter opens up, data moves in, T clock to T. Then processed by the logic, so T logic, worst case delay, maximum delay, worst case value, maximum delay. And then it has to be a stable value before the setup time of the next one. It has to stabilize itself. So that is T setup comes from there. So T clock to queue, T logic, T setup. And when you start adding into the clock uncertainties, that is T zitter, and T skew, skew can be positive, negative. So worst case conditions for T cycle will be? For which case? Everybody knows, sir. Positive skew or negative skew? See, high data rates means minimal T cycle. So anything that is increasing my T cycle, that is what is giving me my worst case values. So that will become, that is going to lower my data rate. Remember that. Okay. So how can you increase, what conditions can increase your T cycle? First of all, look at the skew. Positive skew or negative skew? Negative skew. So negative skew will increase your this expression by an amount delta. But delta is your skew. What is skew? Everybody knows? Skew? Speak in the mic. There's a Goa class also attached.
Suppose we have a synchronous flip-flopper latch and we are giving the same clock. So because of delay, the clock that reaches first flip-flop and the clock that reaches second flip-flop, there is a difference.
Why is there a difference?
Because of the delays, the interconnection delay. Interconnection delay or some delay.
So we should understand. It's okay what you are told, but I think as an engineer, you should make it understand. It's an engineering class. So what will an engineer give an answer? First of all, understand that your skew is a spatial property, whereas the zitter is a temporal property. Understand that. Okay. So when you have a delay coming up in the same signal, which is being distributed at different points on the same in a space, and there's a difference in the arrival of that signal. There's a difference. At one point, it's arriving earlier. Suppose clock edge. Clock edge is coming at point A earlier. It is coming at point B little later. So same signal, ideally it should arrive at the same instant of time. And that is mainly because of the wire delays. So it's a spatial property. Remember that. As the wires are distributed throughout the space on the chip, and as signal travels through that wires, they have a resistance, they have a capacitance, so RC delays. So signal travels through the wire with a delay. So point A, point B, there would be a difference in the arrival of the same clock signal. That is a skew. And zitter is a temporal property which is coming from the circuit generation, clock generation unit. Remember, clock generation unit. It is a response, it's coming from the clock generation. Clock generation should give you the edge. Edge should come at a regular interval of, say, 1 nanosecond. It is a responsibility of the clock generation unit, PLL or the DLL. It is a responsibility. But because of various PVT variations that can happen, as a result of that, your clock generation, clock edge does not always come at interval of 1 nanosecond. It shifts little bit earlier, little bit later. Little bit. That error is minimal, but it is there. It is not zero. This is it. By how much amount it is shifting from the nominal edge, either later or earlier, that is your signal. Always remember. So when we look at the worst case condition for my T cycle, so T cycle is my original three terms. It is my original three terms, that is my T clock to Q of the transmitter, T logic, and T setup of my receiver. Original three terms plus delta, which is my skew, plus zeta. Now understand that the transmitter edge is shifting towards, it is coming little bit later. Now receiver would be sampling it at the next edge. So receiver edge shifts towards the left. As a result, your total time period gets reduced by twice of T zeta. So it is always twice of T zeta that I add. Skew is only delta. It is not twice of delta. Remember that. Okay? So skew is delta, but zeta is twice of T zeta. And add them together, this delta plus twice of T zeta, it becomes T uncertainty, TU, or a timing noise. This is how it is represented in a book by Digital Systems Engineering by Daly and Poulton. Okay? He calls it as a timing noise or as an uncertainty. Now that has a repercussion on eye diagram. When you represent an eye diagram, remember, for best performance, we always want our data to be sampled when the signal is maximally stable. Because then there is no chance of data which is being sampled as to be corrupt. There is no chance. The data is in a corrupted state. So when the data is maximally stable, I should sample, or I should have a clock edge, coming, sampling my data at that instant. That is always at the center of the eye diagram. Always. For best performance, remember, data is always centered, processed at the center of the eye diagram. Now, in this situation, my data, suppose initial bit was 0, new bit is 1. So, my data is rising. Now, look at the data waveform. Data is rising. There would be rise time associated with my data. Then it would be trying to become stable. It stabilizes, maybe rising to its full validity value. Then maybe the next bit is again 0, it will again be falling. If next bit again 0, it will again be falling. So for me, my logic one is from 50% of initial value to the 50% of the next value. So we traditionally, this is how we understand our logic one. So initially 0, then changing to 1. So V50%, you choose that point time on the time scale. Then it is rising, becoming maximum. Then next bit is again 0. So it is again falling. So again the V50% here. So 50% to V50%. These two instants means this is my logic 1 duration. So rise time, fall time. Okay, and then the minimal, in between is my maximally stable time. We call that region in which we sample the data as aperture. That is referred as aperture time, or aperture window, or sampling window. So we always, and that is always in the center of the eye diagram. So that is where we sample our data. The clock edge must always sample it at that instant. Okay, and if I include T uncertainty, so I can have my aperture window shifting this way. I can have my aperture shifting this way. So that is depends on the worst case T uncertainty. So add rise time, uncertainty, aperture window or sampling window, then again uncertainty, and then the fall time. So now if I represent my T cycle in terms of aperture time and T uncertainty, T rise and T fall, what will it be? Expression. I have expressed my T cycle in terms of T setup, T clock, no, T logic. Now I am giving you another approach. Represent your T cycle now in terms of using eye diagram approach. In terms of rise time, T uncertainty, uncertainty, timing noise, aperture, and then fall time, rise fall. Give me the expression. From V50% to V50%, this is your one bit. So total timing in that, T defines your minimum P cycle. It defines your minimum P cycle. Write the expression for T cycle. At least equal to, or it should be greater than. Okay. It must be start from half of T rise or T fall, whatever it may be, plus timing noise this side and timing noise this side of the aperture time. Okay. So twice of T uncertainty. Fine. And then comes your sampling window in between. Add that. So that's aperture time or sampling window duration. And then it would be again a fall. It would be again a fall. Half of T fall or T rise. Button. Understood? Now what? How do you know how much is your aperture time? Now now you can understand how much is T uncertainty. It would be skew plus zeta. Skew plus zeta. Now if I say how much is your sampling window duration, how do you know? According to me, one bit is from V50% to V50%. Okay, I understand that also now. Now how to locate my aperture time in this diagram on the timing scale, on the timing axis? How will you know? So aperture time is always defined between 10% to 10%, if it's a low bit, or 90% to 90% if it is a logic. So duration from 90% if it's logic one, 90% of VDD to 90% of VDD. Remember, initially your bit is changing from 0 to 1, then changing from 1 to 0. So we have a duration in which it is staying within 90% to 90%. Or conversely, for a low level bit, it is remaining within 10% to 10%. That duration is called as sampling window or aperture time. Clear? Understood? So now we start with, as we all know now, these things we have, like something that we have already done. So these things I think you all know. It's just for the sake of continuity. Condition on hold. Everybody knows. Why should we have a condition on hold? Anybody who doesn't know, please raise your hand. You may tell me, I will tell you. Why should we have a condition on T hold? What is T hold? See, communication is happening. Data is transferred from transmitter to receiver. Now there's a sequential latch or a flip-flop at the transmitter and at the receiver. So there is something called T hold for a latch or a flip-flop. I'm sending, remember, any data which is coming at clock edge 1 at the transmitter should move to receiver at the clock edge 2 at the next edge. I should not have a condition that when the data coming at clock edge 1, in the same edge, it moves to the receiver. That should never happen. My data should move only one step at a time. It should not move two step at a time. For proper communication, reliable communication between two blocks. So we want to now prevent that condition. Now, why this condition can occur? Now, this is a hazard. It is a hazard. I need to think of ways by which hazards can appear and then how can we mitigate them. So what possibility can make this hazard to appear? So suppose your T clock to Q is minimal. Suppose. Now remember, your delays are pattern dependent. The delay from 0 to 1 transfer is different as 1 to 0 transfer. Similarly, logical delays for 111 delay will be different. Propagation delay will be different through a logical block. 1010 it would be different. Okay, so we have pattern dependent delays, input pattern dependent. As a result, I can assign with every quantity as a minimum delay and a maximum delay. So T clock to Q minimum, there can be T clock to Q maximum. Similarly, T logic can be minimum, T logic can be maximum. So as a result, think of a situation where everything is minimum. Everything is minimum. So that within no time, the data which is latched or which is being processed by transmitter, within no time, it is available at the output of the transmitter. Within no time, because it is such a minimal condition. Think of everything is minuscule, timing it is taking. So within no time, data is available at the output. Now, when the transmitter is sampling the new data, receiver is sampling the transmitter output. Both are in a transparent stage. They are not off. They are not opaque. They are in a transparent. They are allowing data to move in. And within no time, transmitter output has changed. So by that time, receiver closes. A new data has come in. So whereas it should be latching in the previous output, it would be latching in the new one. Which is a wrong, which is a hazard. It should not happen. So now I put a condition on T hold. T hold is a time taken by the sequential flip-flop or the element to close. Time taken by the flip-flop to close itself. To get opaque, to become opaque. It cannot sample any further. So I said before it closes, I should not have arrival of a new data at the transmitter output. I should not. Otherwise, the next data can move. So this is putting a condition on T hold. I say T hold must be less than the time taken by the transmitter to have a new data coming to its output. Simple. So we have a condition on T hold. So T hold must be less than what? It must be less than T clock to Q minimum plus T logic minimum. Minimal possible. It should not arrive. It should be by the time it closes. If it comes after that, no problem. But if it is not in a closed situation, my data should not arrive at the transmitter out. So if it is 1 nanosecond time, you make your T hold less than 1 nanosecond. If it is arriving in 0.5 nanosecond, minimal time, make your T hold less than 0.5 nanosecond. So that receiver element is close before the new data is arriving. That is a condition on T hold. It is a problem only in positive skew. It becomes a more, you can say, more stringent problem in positive skew. Why? Suppose I give you examples. My T skew is 0.5 nanosecond and my T hold is 1 nanosecond. And there's a positive skew happening. There's a positive skew happening means receiver edge is coming little late because of delay of the clock signal through the wire. Okay, so now I said my T hold problem becomes more problematic for me. Why? Whereas it is not a problem in a negative skew case. It is not a problem in negative, it's a problem in positive skew. Why? Because that skew delta, that what will happen to the T hold now? Will it get modified? Will it remain the same as 1 nanosecond? What will be the new T hold for your receiver? Your delta will get added to it. So now earlier it was taking only 1 nanosecond to close. Now it would be requiring 1.5 nanosecond to close. And data arrival time through the transmitter, now it has a window of 1.5 nanoseconds. Earlier it was only 1 nanosecond. So there was a chance that data may not arrive in 1 nanosecond. Now it is increased to 1.5. This is a larger chance for the data to arrive. There is a higher chance, a higher probability that you may be having corrupted receiver output. So it has to be always less than the T hold plus delta. I am adding a skew. Had it been a negative skew, there would not have been any problem. Why? Negative skew case arrives when data and clock moves in opposite directions. So data moves from left to right, clock moves from right to left. So that by the time data moves in, clock has already reached block 2, then it will reach block 1. So there is a very high chance that block 2 would be, a receiver would be initially closed off by the time new data arrives. Understood? So we do our design by we compute depending on the system level skew. we normally designers, they understand how much global skew and local skew they are going to get. They estimate global skew between two blocks widely placed and local skew between the skew that is tolerable between two blocks which are close. They are placed in close vicinity. So they estimate, depending on the data rate requirement, how much is going to be a global skew, worst case value, and how much is going to be the local skew, worst case value. And then they estimate, okay, I don't know how would I would be routing my wire. Sometimes it may be both in the same direction. Sometimes both may be in opposite direction, data and clock. They may be running opposite to each other. That's all done by softwares. Nowadays, we all know placement and routing routines. Okay? So, any case can happen. So, you may have a skew plus minus delta. You may have a skew plus minus delta. As a result, now I estimate what worst case values I can have. Accordingly, I pre-calculate my T cycle by taking all worst case values. I pre-calculate and then I understand how much data rate I am going to have. Now, suppose I have a target of a certain data rate. I say, no, I want 1 Gbps. Whatever you may do. Accordingly, do a back calculation. For 1 Gbps, knowing the skew values, how much should be your T logic? How much should be your T setup? How much should be your T hold? And then design your sequential elements to have that much T hold, to have that much T setup, and design your logical block to have that much or less than that T logic, so that you can achieve that much data. So when you design registers, flip-flops, they are designed for a certain T clock, 2QT setup and T hold. As a result, we have a variety of flip-flop designs. People have proposed a variety of flip-flop designs, some having very low clock to Q, some having negative setup time, some having zero hold time. You have done those designs? Any of you listen design course? Design of flip-flops? Simple D flip-flop. Variety, sense amplifier based. Pulse latches, pulse flip-flops. Different varieties that have been proposed over the years. Flip-flops using transmission gates, using inverters, combination logical gates, using sense amplifiers, differential pair kind of an arrangement. Flip-flops made by using differential amplifiers. Flip-flops made by using two bistable clocked elements. Bistable element is a cross-coupled inverter. Cross-coupled inverter is a bistable element. Why is it a bistable element? Suppose I ask you this question. Bistable, what is the meaning of a bistable? Which has only two stable states. Okay, so you have cross-coupled inverters. Now look at the cross-coupled inverter. Output of one goes to the input. And it forms a loop. So how does it have a bistable, two stable states? How does it have a two stable states? Now draw the, everybody draws a VTC of the two on the same axis. Draw the VTC of both the inverters, inverter one, inverter two. Output V out of one is V in for another, remember that. And V in for another is V out for the next. Remember, draw the VTC of both the elements on the same axis. There's a, say, voltage levels are 0 to VDD. Just go two CMOS inverters connected back to back. Everybody has drawn. Now, how many crossovers are there? How many meeting points are there? The two VTCs will be crossing each other at certain points. How many points, such points are there? Three. One is at VDD, other is at zero, and the third is at somewhere in the middle. It is normally where? Where is the location of this third point, operating point? At switching threshold. Everybody knows switching threshold or logic threshold? Everybody knows it is roughly at, sometimes usually at VDD by 2. But not necessarily. It may be more than VDD by 2. It can be less than VDD by 2. Switching threshold. Now this switching threshold operating point is highly unstable. There are only two stable states. You will say, madam, there are three. No, there are not three. Three crossovers means doesn't mean two, three stable states, because the middle crossover is a highly unstable, because it lies in which region? Region. It lies in transition region of other VTC. Even a small noise, very small fluctuation, can cause this point to either move to VDD or move to ground. It's highly unstable. So stable states are only by stable element. So this works like a memory element, by stable. So I can create a flip-flop by using a bistable element. There are various ways of making a bistable element. Modified inverters are used. Remember that. Okay. So we have done that. So once we understand that, I can create a number of do I need to go through this discussion of the design of flip-flops? Somebody saying yes, somebody saying no. Yes. Okay, then I need to prepare myself for that. I thought you all have done, so I might not be required for that. So design, these are also called as a design of registers. Rabia calls it as a registers. These are nothing but flip-flops. Okay, so flip-flops are nothing but two latches combined together, always. Two latches, one positive level sensitive, other is negative level sensitive. Okay, so before I understand, I start making the design, let us understand the timing properties of a flip-flop and timing property of a latch. We all know that. It may be just a repetition for many of you. Yes. This is a property, timing property of a flip-flop. This is as it is given in Daly's book. It is differently given in Rabia's book. But concept is the same. Notations are slightly different. Remember that. So flip-flop, there's a clock signal. It's a synchronous element. Data goes in, output is Q. We all know that. It's just a repetition, I think. You all know that. So clock changes, maybe a positive edge trigger. Clock changes. Okay. Data is stable here. So from clock edge, which is taken as V 50% point. Remember, clock is never ideal. So transition point is taken as at the V 50% instant. So this is the middle point. This is the point I would be referring as my transition in the clock. So I'm comparing, I'm measuring everything with respect to this instant of time. So from here, it should be stable by a certain duration before the clock edge. So T setup. So data is stable here. It should be stable, does not change after the clock edge. So this is T hold. Now remember here, everything is measured here with the referenced edge, clock, positive clock edge. With a single edge, everything is, I'm measuring with respect to the positive clock edge. For negative edge trigger, it would be, everything would be referenced with respect to the negative clock edge. This is a property of a flip-flop. It is not so for a latch. Remember that. For a level sensitive element, it is different. So this is T setup, T hold. Now, this is my center point. Okay. From this point, now remember, from here to here, 10% to 10% T aperture. Or 90% to 90% is T aperture. Aperture window. Remember, T uncertainty is not included in this. It is only data we are representing. I am not showing an eye diagram. This is not an eye diagram. It's just the data. So T aperture, T setup here, T hold here. How much is your T aperture offset? So we allow some offset in my aperture window. How much that offset is allowed? So it is from clock transition to the clock rising, clock edge starting, rising or falling. So this is my aperture offset time. I say, okay, that much offset I can tolerate in my sampling window. Okay? So this is D aperture offset. Now there are two clock to Q delays. So this is maximum TDCQ and this is minimal PCCQ. C stands for, they call it as a contamination delay. Contamination delay. So contamination delay is minimal and maximal is T data C to Q. So clock to Q delay maximal from clock edge till the maximum change in Q, latest change in Q. Similarly, earliest change in Q, that gives you T C C Q. Contamination clock to Q. Understand? Now if I go to a latch, now here you will see the difference. I have a clock to Q reference to the positive edge of the clock. Whereas setup hold time, they are reference to the negative edge. This is the difference between a latch and a flip-flop. Understand that, because later when you start making timing diagrams, these things will be required. You might be knowing, you might not be knowing. Okay? So for a latch, latch opens up at the positive edge. Okay? So we have a maximal clock to Q delay and a minimal clock to Q. Now here, latch remains open. It is not edge-triggered operation. Latch remains open as long as your clock is high. So problem comes when it closes. Then if you not take care, you may have a wrong value remaining stored in the latch. There is a chance that one which is stored may change to zero because there is a sudden spike in data. So my latch is closing at the falling edge of the clock. If I don't take care in the data and data has a certain transition, suppose a spike comes in and the next moment clock goes low, then what is stored in my latch is zero or a spike value, which is incorrect because it is just a momentary transition. So I should not allow that. So when it closes, I should take care. So data should not change before a certain duration. When the latch closes, so T setup here. And again a T hold, because latch will not get closed immediately, it takes time. So we give it time before the edge, clock edge, and we give it time after the clock edge. So T setup and T hold. And also if change is happening, clock is high, latch is transparent, and there is a change in data happening, then it should happen T setup time before the falling edge of the clock. If it has to be stored, it should happen, it should change at least one setup time before the falling edge of the clock, if it is a valid value. I am not talking of a spike. So we have another property here. There we have only T clock to Q. Here we have a T data to Q also. In latch there is additional time property, which is T D data to Q and T C data to Q. The minimal and the maximal data to Q. Data variation to the change in Q. So these are two different values. Understand everybody? And then we also understand in terms of the CLB. Suppose there is a block, CLB. And there are different inputs. And there are different outputs. Here again you can have different values for low level, TD low level and TD high level output. So TD low level A to X. And similarly, TD high level A to X. There can be two different values. Similarly, we can have a TD contamination. Again, for low level, maximal, low level, minimal. Similarly, low, high level, maximal, high level, minimal. Remember that. Okay? So you may have this situation. Just these are some kind of an introduction to notation that is being used in the DALIS book. Right? So he has made these diagrams to make you understand the different notations he would be using in his book. So whatever he is representing here, it is being represented in this example. Just go through. And then talking about the timing uncertainty. Minimal and maximum skew property. What maximum clock skew? Worst case value. And what can be the minimal or maximum jitter worst case value? So if I have a clock signal A, it is being distributed to two different locations B and C. And because of PBT variations, the clock signal at B gets shifted with respect to the clock signal received at the C because of various PVT variations. As a result, the maximal skew taken by any designer while making a budget estimate, he understands that maximum skew. Now, Dalys used the value TK, notation TK for representing skew. So T skew between B and C is sum of the two skew between A to B and A to C. Worst case, he takes this as the worst. It cannot be more than that. It can always be less than that. Similarly, the maximal zitter between B and C in the clock signal, again the summation of two zitters between A to B and A to C. What maximum zitter you can have? Okay? So twice of T. This is a worst case value which is taken while making a budget estimate. Then in your feedbacks, in your synchronous timing approach, I may not always have a data moving in a forward way. It's a feedback loop. Data can come back to the block one. So this is called as a feedback timing. Feedback state timing where data moves from here to here then comes back. Now here what will be T cycle? Can you do it? Can you write the expression for T? Now it will not be same as whatever we have written earlier. T cycle expression now will change. So that will govern your, put another constraint on the data rate which can be achieved. So under feedback, what can be T cycle expression? Everything is given over here. Let me understand why this T cycle must be this. Just give it a thought. Look at this. You have this clock signal distributed to this D flip-flop and this flip-flop. And there may be a skew between phi E and phi L. The skew is TK. That skew is represented as TK. And then A opens up at the edge, phi E comes in. And B opens up at the edge, phi L comes in. So when the A opens up, A gets the changed value. So A changes here. As the A changes here from this edge to this edge, minimal, you can say TC, CQ. Earliest arriving of the A signal. So this is TC, CQ. Okay, similarly, phi L changes here. And then B changes here. Again, that value that is you will be having between B and C. Now you may show it like this kind of eye diagram to show CQ and DQ. So earlier arriving of the B data and the latest arriving of your B data. You can represent them, but here it is representing only one thing: C for A and D for CQ. Okay. Now from here. For this edge, now this is T hold. This is the edge at which the B is getting the data. So from clock edge, it should remain stable for a certain duration. What should remain stable? What should remain stable for a certain duration? Which signal should remain stable for a certain duration? It's the feedback. Why? Y should not change. Remember, Y is coming back. Y is coming back. And then B is getting realized. So my Y should not change. This must be my hold period. It should remain stable. Otherwise, my B value will get corrupted. My B value will get corrupted. So there is a constraint on Y also for proper movement of data. Because Y is moving to B and B is moving to Y. It's a loop. So you have to create your diagram first and then start writing equations. Start writing equation from this diagram, T cycle time. T cycle minimal A to Y, TD maximal B to Y. And find out TCY. Your TCY is this expression. Now if I give you a task, this expression, and remove the feedback loop from here. Remove feedback. And then again write TCY, T cycle. And then compare the two. Where you find the difference? How does the two expressions, they differ each other? I'm taking take two cases. In one case, remove this wire. And second case, have this wire. Okay? And then write the expression for TCY with the same notation that I'm using over here. TK, TH, TCAY, whatever it is. Which expression, how does the expression will change with each other? Which terms will change? Do it. One case with feedback, other case without feedback. Write the two expressions. First of all, just write two expressions. For T cycle. Time is over. Okay, then we stop here. You do it. Next time we'll discuss. Okay, do it. Please do it. See how does the two things change and which can cause, which expression will cause a deterrent to receiving high data rates. Which one will give you a larger T cycle? Okay, please. Register. Let us just...